I'm Natalie Canterbury. Warm welcome to all of you. Today, I would like to deliver my lecture on the topic Jane Eyre by Charlotte Bronte. And in this lecture, I shall be elaborating summary and critical commentary from chapter 1 to 16. As far as objectives of this lecture is concerned, my first objective is to give students a general overview of the novel's plot. So it's really important for me as a teacher to let you know about the overall idea of the novel so that you can mentally be the part of the second objective of this is to critically analyze important points from the text to develop your cognitive and critical thinking. To elaborate the concept of critical thinking is basically analysis of facts to form judgment. So it is basically a rational or what I would say unbiased analysis of a text, and the approach that is used in critical thinking is self-directed, self-disciplined, and it is so for example, an example of critical thinking is this, that reading a novel that is based on partition. So in this novel, if a writer is talking about some sort of dispute, so in this particular novel, you would keep your personal religious sentiments away while you are analyzing the text. So this will be a neutral and at the same time a critical approach. Secondly, next objective of this lecture is to discuss text from different theoretical angles. I know this is second semester and you people have just started reading literature as a subject, but in this particular novel, my approach would be to discuss some basic critical theories with you. For example, psychoanalysis, psychoanalytical theory, and feminist theory, so that you people can learn about these theories along with the text as well. Okay, then next objective is to highlight different literary techniques. So, particular lecture, I would like to talk about different literary techniques that are used by author in the text, like the way he develops his plot, the way he analyzes his character, the way Charlotte Bronte talks about the way her metaphors, the way she develops her plot, and the way she uses different symbols in the text. So I will be highlighting these literary techniques as well. The next objective is to learn core aesthetics of fiction. So aesthetics are basically the formula. To make it simple, it's basically a formula that is used to create a fiction, right? So in this particular lecture, I would like to analyze and I would like to highlight the points or the formula that is, or the literary or I would say the literary techniques that are used by the author in the development of different chapters, right? So that you people can learn the fiction on very basic level. Okay, the next objective is to comprehend listening material and develop listening skills as well. So this time we have started teaching you. So in this lecture, at the end of the lecture, I have given you a kind of homework and a kind of activity as well. So at the end of the lecture, you can while making your assignment or while doing your homework, you people will come across different kind of listening material as well. So it will also be a test of your listening skills as well. And the lecture will also focus on your comprehension skills, your listening skills, your reading skills, and your writing skills as well. And the next objective is to reflect on their own learning. So in this lecture, you people are you will learn about reflection. The terminology that I would like to use is the self-reflection. Now, self-reflection is this, that you people are watching yourself in the mirror. Self-reflection is basic terminology that is used in modern English classrooms. In these kind of activities, you people, at the start of the lecture, you people question yourself that where am I standing at the moment? Like about the topic Jane Eyre, your knowledge parameter is like 1 by 10 in the beginning, and maybe at the end of the lecture it turns out to be 9 by 10. So this is how you are reflecting your own self in online teaching classrooms. You people are judging your own self that where am I standing in the beginning of the lecture and where am I standing at the ending of the lecture. Okay, then the last objective is to develop your intellectual independence through analytical activities. So thing is that as far as I have seen students, what they do is that most of the times they are just memorizing the stuff that is taught by their teachers in the classroom, right? So I do not agree with that. I do not consider it a very useful way of reading literature. So in this lecture, I have kept in mind that by the end of this lecture, you people should be able to make yourself independent intellectually. Like after reading the lecture, you may agree or disagree. Okay, so let's discuss the format of the lecture. In this format, I am going to elaborate some of the important events that are taking place in chapters, and then after elaborating a basic summary of those chapters, then I am going to discuss a critical analysis of the chapters. So let's discuss with chapter 1. In chapter 1, basically the novel opens on a dreary November afternoon at Gateshead, the home of the wealthy Reed family. A young girl named Jane Eyre sits in the drawing room reading Bewick's History of British Birds. Jane's aunt, Mrs. Reed, has forbidden her niece to play with her cousins Eliza, Georgiana, and Bowling John. John chides Jane for being a lonely orphan who is only permitted to live with the Reeds because of his mother's charity. John then hurls a book at the young girl, pushing her to the end of her patience. Jane finally erupts and the two cousins fight. Mrs. Reed holds Jane responsible for the scuffle and sends her to the Red Room, the frightening chamber in which her Uncle Reed died, as punishment. So now let's discuss summary of chapter number 2. In chapter number 2, two servants, Miss Abbott, Bessie Lee, escorts Jane to the Red Room, and Jane basically resists them to with all of her might. Once locked in the room, Jane catches a glimpse of her ghastly figure in the mirror, and shocked by her meager presence, she begins to reflect on the events that have led her to such a state. She remembers her kind Uncle Reed bringing her to Gateshead after her parents' death, and she recalls his dying command that his wife promised to raise Jane as one of her own. Suddenly, Jane is struck with the impression that her Uncle Reed's ghost is in the room, and she imagines that he has come to take revenge on his wife for breaking her promise. Jane cries out in terror, but her aunt believes that she is just trying to escape her punishment, and she ignores her pleas. Jane faints in exhaustion and fear. Now let's discuss a summary of chapter 3. These are the following events that are taking place in chapter 3. In chapter 3, basically, when Jane wakes, Jane finds herself in her own bedroom in the care of Mr. Lloyd, the family's kind apothecary. Bessie is also present, and she expresses disapproval of her mistress' treatment of Jane. Jane remains in bed the following day, and Bessie sings her a song. Mr. Lloyd speaks with Jane about her life at Gateshead, and he suggests to Jane's aunt that the girls be sent away to school where she might find happiness. Jane is, at this point we see that Jane is cautiously excited at the possibility of leaving Gateshead. And soon after, her own reflections on the past in the Red Room, Jane learns more of her history when she overhears a conversation between Bessie and Miss Abbott about Jane's mother, who was a member of the Wealthy Reed family, which strongly disapproved of Jane's father, an impoverished clergyman. When they married, Jane's wealthy maternal grandfather wrote his father out of his will. Not long after Jane was born, Jane's parents died from typhus, which Jane's father contracted while he was caring for the poor. Then let's discuss summary and some important events that were taking place in chapter 4. In chapter 4, about 2 months have passed, and Jane has been enduring even cruel treatment from her aunt and cousins while anxiously waiting for the arrangements to be made for her schooling. Now Jane is finally told like she may attend the girls' school Slowood, and she is introduced to Mr. Brocklehurst, the stern-faced man who runs the school. Mr. Brocklehurst aggressively questions Jane about religion, and he reacts with indignation when she declared that she finds Sam's uninteresting. Jane's aunt warns Mr. Brocklehurst that the girl also has a propensity for lying. A piece of information that Mr. Brocklehurst says he intends to plead publicized to Jane's teachers upon. Now let's discuss a very important point, that is when Mr. Brocklehurst leaves, Jane is so hurt by her aunt's accusation that she cannot stop herself from defending herself to her aunt. Mrs. Reeds, for once, seems to concede defeat. Shortly thereafter, Bessie tells Jane that she prefers her to the Reed children, and before Jane leaves for school, Bessie tells her stories and sings her lovely songs. Okay, now I'm going to discuss critical analysis of the novel from chapter 1 to 4. And first of all, the most important point in this chapter is basically the establishment of Jane Eyre's character. So, in the early chapters that I have noticed is that Bronte establishes the young Jane's character through her confrontations with John and Mrs. Reed. So this is the very first account of Jane Eyre, in which we see Jane's good-hearted but strong-willed determination and integrity become very apparent to us as readers. Then these chapters are also establishing novel's mood for the rest of the novel. So beginning with Jane's experience in the Red Room in chapter 1 to chapter 4, we sense basically a palpable atmosphere of mystery and the supernatural. So we see in the very first chapter that the atmosphere of mystery and supernatural is there, and then the mood of the novel is settled. A very important point to discuss in early chapters of the novels is Charlotte Bronte's position as a Gothic writer. Very much like Emily Bronte, who is her sister, and her novel Wuthering Heights, Jane Eyre basically draws a great deal of its stylistic inspiration from the Gothic novels that were in vogue during the late 18th and early 19th century. And these books depicted remote, desolate landscape, crumbling ruins, and supernatural events, all of which were designed to create a sense of psychological suspense and horror. While Jane Eyre is not certainly a horror novel, and its intellectually ambitious systems of society make it far more than a typical Gothic romance, it is Bronte's employment of Gothic conventions that give her novel popular as well as intellectual appeal. So, in Jane Eyre, Charlotte Bronte places her narrator and central character in the middle of dramatic events. And one of these is at the start of the novel when Jane is trapped in the Red Room, and the next is when she attends Thornfield Hall to work as a governess. So, Charlotte Bronte uses certain features of Gothic fiction to create a sense of tense atmosphere for the reader. Jane Eyre is sent to live with her unfeeling aunt and abusive cousins after her parents sadly passed away. Jane Eyre leads a very unhappy life as the people whom she grows up with do not treat her like family and blame her for any trouble. Now we see that Jane Eyre is locked in the Red Room after an incident with her cousins, for which she takes the blame. As the years pass and Jane grows into a young family, she is sent to Thornfield to work as a governess, and in the passage is being shown around the estate. So in the Red Room and at the Thornfield, we see that Bronte establishes a typically gloomy Gothic setting to create suspense and terror. Charlotte Bronte uses powerfully Gothic descriptions of objects, especially in the Red Room. The name seems more important because of the alliteration, like alliteration is basically the repetition of the first word, in a row. So, for example, the first letter in the row. So, in red room, R, and in room, R is repeating over and over. Therefore, it is alliteration. The name seems more important because of the alliteration, and the fact that the room is identified as red makes the reader feel that it is perhaps dangerous. Because the color red is associated with danger, the color talks about the intense danger and the intense loneliness of the human situation. We are in this particular chapter, we are told by the narrator that the red room was a square chamber, very seldom slept in, I might say never. The use of the word chamber in this text makes it sound much larger and grander and perhaps more uninviting than a regular room. The fact that the room is hardly ever slept in suggests that it is abandoned by all humans company and creates a tense mood for the reader, raising several questions about its safety, right? So the safety of living in this room becomes a question for Jane Eyre. Bronte therefore uses colors to reflect the turmoil of emotions such as rage, fear and frustration which Jane is now experiencing in this room. The objects which Charlotte Bronte describes in the Red Room create a typical Gothic environment. We are told that the room is decorated very darkly, and we know that all the dark colors such as brown, black, red or a mixture of these, mustard and a mixture of these colors, they are associated with mostly with the Gothic colors or with dark things or with evil things, right? So the chains were of look at the description that is given in the novel. The chairs were of darkly polished old mahogany, which suggests that the furniture in the room is somber, old and heavy. Colors associated with the Gothic are generally darker shades, and the Red Room purposely creates images in the reader's mind of gloomy objects to create a depressing atmosphere. So when the writer describes the bed as glaring white and the snowy marcel counterpane, this creates a contrast to the surrounding redness of the rest of the room. Glared white uses personification to describe the bedding as antagonist to Jane, as if it is watching her, right? So the personification is used with furnitures. Here in the room, it looks like everything is very much alive. So it gives a very dark image of the place. So this images create basically a torment in the mind of the readers. Even though the color white might seem a very optimistic color than red, here it is used to create negative thoughts. The snowy white counterpane presents the bed as being icy cold, like death. When Jane looks in the mirror, she sees a half imp, half fairy staring back at her. So this introduces an element of the supernatural and suggests that Jane believes evil forces within the room may have possessed her and are reflected in the glass. Charlotte Bronte plays here on the superstitious fears of the reader. The fact that Jane Eyre is trapped in the Red Room where her uncle died is terrifying enough, but the idea that the room might have the power to drive Jane mad plays on our deepest anxieties. So the author is not here playing with Jane Eyre's feelings, but here she is also playing with anxieties of the reader. The descriptions of when Jane looks in the mirror, death is a prominent feature of the Gothic we see here, and Bronte here uses the dead uncle and the possibility that he haunts the room to intensify the atmospheres. When Jane looks in the mirror, it is most disturbing moment in the description of the Red Room. Horror and fascination are created for Jane at this moment. The description of her white face and glittering eyes of fear show that Jane appears like a ghost to herself, the word glittering hinting at madness. The idea that Jane is trapped in the Red Room creates a strong impression, and Jane's statement that they went shutting the room and locked it behind them creates terror for the reader. And the simple literal description brings a sense of awful finality to their actions. Here, Jane is separated from the rest of the family and is unable to escape from the Red Room and must face its ghostly terrors alone. People fear the madness which might come from being locked away in confined spaces. Jane Eyre has been excluded from everyone and everything she knows. Jane Eyre features a strong supernatural element to make these passages memorable. Miss Abbott tells Jane, just look at the description when she says, Miss Abbott tells Jane that something bad might be permitted to come down the chimney and fetch you away. This dialogue is basically coming as a threat to Jane Eyre that something like a spirit or devil will hurt her if she moves from the room. Use of the word permitted by the servant actually makes Jane feel that if something did take her away, she would have deserved it. The spell which kept it so lonely in spite of its grandeur suggests that although the chamber is large, it still remains lonely and quiet, as no one has entered the room since the death of Mr. Reed. Questions are raised about why no one has entered the room and why people are afraid. The information that Mr. Reed breathes his last in this room suggests that his spirit still lingered in the room after his death, and this creates a sense and mysterious atmosphere for the reader, hinting at the fact that the room is maybe haunted. So this is giving so all the dialogues are also giving the idea that the room may be haunted. Then Charlotte Bronte also uses a lot of religious associations to add impact to her presentation of significant events. Actually, in the 19th century, religious beliefs were very influential. In this part of the novel, the housemaids like Bessie and Miss Abbott treat Jane very harshly, and they say that God will punish her, he might strike her dead in the midst of her tantrums. So here we see that the maids choose to use God as a threat, hoping that that will scare Jane into behaving appropriately. So here we see at this level we see that God is presented here as a harsh, daunting judge who is capable of hurting Jane. Bronte uses servant's alarmist words to create a strong sense of threat to Jane's safety in the room. Charlotte Bronte, I think, definitely uses the Gothic throughout her novel Jane Eyre, and especially in the beginning of the chapter, to create fear and anxiety for her central character. And Bronte focuses on the darker side of human feeling, using period settings in particular to reflect a sense of the unknown and to create tension in her novel. Even today, I know you people are watching a lot of movies. You people see that you people might have seen the movie Twilight. You might have watched movie like Harry Potter. These books all feature some part of the Gothic as well. So at that time, I believe Bronte recognized the power of a Gothic genre that had to represent at that time. So a very important point That a very important point that I would like to discuss now is of social class and injustice. So, from the beginning of the novel, we see that Jane Eyre explores and challenges the social preconception of 19th century Victorian society. Themes of social class, gender relations, and injustice predominate throughout the novel. Jane Eyre brings her story of an orphan raised by a wealthy, cultivated family, and this ambiguous social standing motivates much of the novel's internal tension and conflicts. Jane's education and her semi-aristocratic lifestyle as those of the upper class, because she's a governess, but as a penniless orphan, she's forced to live on the charity of others. Here, Jane is a kind of second-class citizen, I believe. In some ways, she is below even the servants, who certainly have no obligation to treat her respectfully. The tension of the contradiction emerges in the very first chapter of the novel, when we see that Jane suffers teasing and she's punished at the hands of John Reed, who is her cousin and his hateful mother. Jane's banishment to the Red Room, we see that this exemplifies her inferior position with regard to the rest of the members of the Reed household. A very important metaphor that I would like to discuss in first four chapters of the novel is of room. But first of all, let me elaborate what is a metaphor. A metaphor is basically a figure of speech that makes an implicit, implied, or hidden comparison between two things that are unrelated, but which share some common characteristics. In other words, a resemblance of contradictory or different objects is made based on a single or some common characteristics. So, in this novel, we see that Red Room, we see see it in terms of a series of literary and metaphorical imprisonments. For example, although Jane's imprisonment in the Red Room is real, she will encounter spiritual, intellectual, and emotional imprisonment throughout the book. The rigid Victorian hierarchies of social class and gender will pose challenge to her freedom of movement and personal growth, and corrupt morals and religion will also constitute menaces to her ability to realize her dreams for herself. Jane will even, in this novel, we will also see that Jane will even come to fear enslavement to her own passions. And at the same time, the Red Room is also symbolic of Jane's feeling of isolation with respect to every community. She is locked in, but she is also in a sense locked out. So the metaphor is working as a double-edged weapon. She is locked in and she is locked out. Again, class and gender hierarchies will contribute to Jane's sense of exile. For example, her position in the later chapters, we will also see that her positions as a governess at Thornfield once again constitutes her in a strange borderland between the upper class and the servant class, so that she feels part of neither group. Now let's discuss some of the important events from chapter 5. 4 days after meeting Brocklehurst, Jane boards the 6 a.m. coach and travels along to Lowood. When she arrives at the school, the day is dark and rainy. She is led through a grim building that will be her new home. The following day, Jane is introduced to her classmates and learns the daily routine, which keeps the girls occupied from before dawn until dinner. Miss Temple, the superintendent of the school, is very kind, while one of Jane's teacher, Miss Catchard, is unpleasant, particularly in her harsh treatment of a young student named Helen Burns. Jane and Helen befriend one another, and Jane learns from Helen that Lord is the charity school maintained for female orphans, which means that the Reeds have paid nothing to put her there. She also learns that Brocklehurst oversees every aspect of his operation. Even Miss Temple must answer to him. Now let's see a few important events. That are taking place in chapter number 6. On Jane's second morning at Lowood, the girls are unable to wash as the water in their pitchers is frozen. Jane quickly learns that life at the school is harsh. The girls are underfed, they are overworked and forced to sit still during seemingly endless sermons. Still, she takes comfort in her new friendship with Helen, who impresses Jane with her expansive knowledge and her ability to patiently endure even the cruelest treatment from Miss Catchard. Helen tells Jane that she practices a doctrine of Christian endurance, which means loving her enemies and accepting her privation. Jane disagrees strongly with such meek tolerance of injustice, but Helen takes no heed of Jane's arguments. Here we see that Helen is self-critical only because she sometimes fails to live up to her ascetic standards. She believes that she is a poor student and chastises herself for daydreaming about her home and family, which she should be concentrating on her studies. Now let's discuss some of the important events that are taking place in chapter number 7. In chapter number 7, for most of Jane's first month at Lowood, Mr. Brocklehurst spends his time away from the school. When she returns, Jane becomes quite nervous because she remembers his promise to her aunt, Mrs. Reeds, to warn school about Jane's supposed habit of lying. When Jane inadvertently drops her slate in Mr. Brocklehurst's presence, he is furious and tells her she is careless. He orders Jane to stand on a stool while she tells the school that she's a liar. And he forbids the other students to speak to her for the rest of the day. Helen makes Jane's day of humiliation endurable by providing her friend with silent consolation. She covertly smiles at Jane every time she passes by. Now, let's discuss a few important events that are taking place in chapter number 8. Finally, at 5 o'clock, the students disperse and Jane collapses to the floor. Deeply ashamed, she is certain that her reputation at Lowood has been ruined. But Helen assures her that most of the girls felt more pity for Jane than revulsion at her alleged deceitfulness. Jane tells Miss Temple that she is not a liar and relates the story of her tormented childhood at Gateshead. Miss Temple seems to believe Jane and writes to Mr. Lloyd requesting confirmation of Jane's account of events. Miss Temple offers Jane and Helen tea and seed cake while they are with her, endearing herself even further to Jane. When Mr. Lloyd's letter arrives and corroborates Jade's story, Miss Temple publicly declares Jane to be innocent. Relieved and contented, Jane herself devotes to her studies. She excels at drawing and makes progress in French. Now let's discuss a few important events that are taking place in chapter number 9. In chapter number 9. In the spring, life at Lawood briefly seems happier, but the damp forest dell in which the school resides is a breeding ground for typhus, and in the warm temperatures, more than half of the girls fall ill with the disease. Jane remains healthy and spends her time playing outdoors with a new friend, Mary Ann Wilson. Helen is sick, but not with typhus. Jane learns the horrific news that her friend is dying of consumption. One evening, Jane sneaks into Miss Temple's room to see Helen one last time. Helen promises Jane that she feels little pain and is almost happy to be leaving the world suffering behind. Here we also see that Jane takes Helen into her arms and then girls fall asleep. During the night Helen dies, her grave is originally unmarked, but 15 years after her death, a gray marble tablet is placed over the spot bearing the single word resurgam, which is the word that is basically from Latin, which means I shall rise again. Okay, then let's discuss chapter number 10 and the events that are taking place in chapter 10. In chapter 10, we see that after Mr. Brocklehurst's negligent treatment of the girls at Lawood is found to be one of the causes of typhus epidemic, a new group of overseers is brought in to run the school. Conditions improve dramatically for the young girls, and Jane excels in her studies for the next 6 years. After spending 2 more years at Lawood as a teacher, Jane decides she is ready for a change, partly because Miss Temple gets married and leaves the school. She advertises in search of a post as a governess and accepts a position at a manor called Thornfield. Before leaving, Jane receives a visit from Bessie, who tells her what has happened at Gateshead since Jane departed for Lawood. She tells her about Georgiana's attempt to run away in secret with a man named Lord Edwinvere, but Eliza foiled the plan by revealing it to Mrs. Reed. John has fallen into a life of debauchery and dissolution. Bessie also tells Jane that her father's brother, John Eyre, appeared at Gateshead 7 years ago looking for Jane. He didn't have the time to travel to Lawood and went away to Madeira, which is basically a Portuguese Iceland west of Morocco, in search of wealth. Jane and Bessie part ways, and then Bessie returning to Gateshead and Jane leaving for her new life at Thornfield. Okay, now I'm going to discuss critical analysis from chapter 5 to 10. The most important point that I want to discuss from chapter 5 to 10 is basically of plot development. So this section actually details Jane's experiences at Lawood from her first day at the school to her final one some 9 years later. Jane's early years at Lawood proves to be a period of considerable tribulation, as she endures hard condition, cruel teachers, and we see tyranny of Mr. Brocklehurst. Moreover, the harsh conditions she experiences as a student at Lawood shows us that despite Jane's intelligence, talent, and self-assurance, she remains merely a burden in the eyes of society because she is a poor girl. Okay, then a very important point that we see in these chapters are of contrasting modes of religious thought. So the most important thematic elements in these sections are the contrasting most of religious thought that is represented by Mr. Brocklehurst and Helen Burns. So Mr. Brocklehurst is basically a religious hypocrite, who's basically supporting his own religious doctrine, and he's basically supporting his own luxurious wealthy family at the expense of the Lowood students, and he's using his piety as an instrument of power over the lower classes and girls at Lowood. He claims that he's purging his students of pride by subjecting them to various privations and humiliations. For example, we see in the text that he orders that naturally curly hair of one of Jane's classmates be cut so as to lie straight, because he believes that hair of women, they are a symbol of pride, and they shouldn't be natural, right? They should be straight. They shouldn't be something with pride. So here we see one religious mode that we see in this text is of the angelic Helen Burns and her doctrine of endurance that represent a religious position that contrasts with Mr. Brocklehurst, utterly passive and accepting of any objection. So Helen embodies rather than preaches the Christian ideas of love and forgiveness. But neither form of religion satisfies Jane because of her strong sensitivity to indignities and injustices. It reviles Brocklehurst's shallow devotional displays and fails to understand Helen Burns' passivity. As Jane herself declares in the novel, I'm reading from the novel, this is chapter 6, where she says, "When we are stuck at without a reason, we should strike back again very hard so as to teach the person who stuck us never to do it again." So Helen's doctrine of endurance and love is incompatible with Jane's belief in fairness and self-respect. So these two modes of religious thoughts, one is of Mr. Brocklehurst and other one is of Helen Burns, these are two extremes, and somewhere we find Jane in between. Okay, now let's discuss important events that are taking place in chapter number 11. In chapter 11, Jane's driver is late picking her up from station at Mill Court. When she finally arrives at Thornfield, it is night time. Although she cannot distinguish much of the house facade from among the shadows, she finds the interior cozy and agreeable. Mrs. Fairfax, a prim elderly woman, is waiting for Jane. It turns out that Mrs. Fairfax is not, as Jane had assumed from their correspondence, the owner of Thornfield, but rather housekeeper. Thornfield's owner, Mr. Rochester, travels regularly and leaves much of the manor's management to Mrs. Fairfax. Jane learns that she will be tutoring Adele, an 18-year-old French girl whose mother was a singer and a dancer. Mrs. Fairfax also tells Jane about Rochester, saying that he is an eccentric man whose family has a history of extreme and violent behavior. Suddenly, Jane hears a peal of strange, eerie laughter echoing through the house, and Mrs. Fairfax here summons someone named Grace, whom she orders to make less noise and to remember directions. When Grace leaves, Mrs. Fairfax explains that she is a rather unbalanced and unpredictable seamstress who works in the house. Now let's discuss some of the important events that are taking place in chapter number 12. In chapter number 12, Jane finds life at Thornfield pleasant and comfortable Adele proved to be exuberant and intelligent, though spoiled and at times a bit petulant. Nonetheless, we see Jane is frequently restless and collects her thoughts while pacing Thornfield's top story passageway. One evening, a few months after her arrival at Thornfield, Jane is alone watching the moon rise when she perceives a horse approaching. It calls to her mind the story Bessie once told her of a spirit called Ajaitrash, which disguises itself as a mule, dog, a horse, or to frighten belated travelers. So, oddly enough, a dog then appears as well. At that time, once she realized that the horse has a rider, the uncanny movement ceases just after the horse passes her. It slips on a patch of ice and its rider tumbles to the ground. Jane helps the man rise to his feet and introduces herself to him. She observed that he has a dark face, stern features, and a heavy brow. He's not quite middle-aged. Upon re-entering Thornfield, Jane goes to Mrs. Fairfax's room and sees the same dog, Pilot, resting on the rug. A servant answers Jane's queries, explaining that the dog belongs to Mr. Rochester, who has just returned home with a sprained ankle, having fallen from his horse. Now let's see the basic incidents, major incidents that are taking place in chapter 13. The day following his arrival, Mr. Rochester invites Jane and Adele to have tea with him. He is abrupt and rather cool toward both of them, although he seems charmed by Jane's drawings, which he asks to see when Jane mentions to Mrs. Fairfax that she finds Rochester's changeful and abrupt. Mrs. Fairfax suggests that mannerisms are the result of a difficult personal history. Rochester was something of a family outcast, and when his father died, his older brother inherited Thornfield. Rochester has been Thornfield's proprietor for 9 years since the death of his brother. Okay, now let's discuss the major events that are taking place in chapter number 14. In chapter 14, we see that Jane sees little of Rochester during the first days at Thornfield. One night, however, in his after-dinner mood, Rochester sent for Jane and Adele. He gives Adele the present she has been anxiously waiting, and while Adele plays, Rochester is uncharacteristically chatty with Jane. When Rochester asks Jane whether she thinks him handsome, she answers no without thinking, and from Rochester's voluble reaction, Jane concludes that he's slightly drunk. Rochester's command that she converse with him makes Jane feel awkward, especially because he goes on to argue that her relation to him is not one of servitude. Their conversation turns to the concept of sin, forgiveness, and redemption. When Adele mentions her mother, Jane is intrigued, and Rochester promises to explain more about the situation on a future occasion. Now let's discuss the major events that are taking place in chapter number 15. In chapter number 15, a while later, Rochester fulfills his promise to Jane to tell her about his and Adele's past. He had a long affair with Adele's mother, the French singer and dancer named Celine Varens, When he discovered that Celine was engaged in a relationship with another man, Rochester ended the relationship. Rochester had always denied Celine's claim that Adele is his daughter. Noting that the child looks utterly unlike him. Even so, when Celine abandoned her daughter, Rochester brought Adele to London so that she would be properly cared for. Jane lies awake, brooding about the strained insight she has gained into her employer's past. She hears about sound like fingers brushing against the walls. And an eerie laugh soon emanates from the hallway. She hears a door opening and hurries out of her room to see smoke coming from Rochester's room. Jane dashes into his room and finds his bed curtains ablaze. She douses the bed with water, saving Rochester's life. Strangely, Rochester's reaction is to visit the third floor of the house. When he returns, he says mysteriously, "I have fallen it all out. It is just as I thought." He inquires whether Jane has ever heard the eerie laughter before, and she answers that she has heard Grace Poole laugh in the same way, just as Grace Poole, you have guessed it, Rochester says. Rochester confirms and he thanks Jane for saving his life and cautions her to tell no one about the details of the night's events. He sleeps on the library sofa for the remainder of the night. Now let's discuss the important events that are taking place in chapter number 16. The next morning, Jane is shocked to learn that the near tragedy of the night before has caused no scandal. The servants believe Rochester to have fallen asleep with a lit candle by his bed, and even Grace Poole shows no sign of guilt or remorse. Jane cannot imagine why an attempted murder is allowed to continue working at Thornfield. She realizes that she is beginning to have feelings for Chester and is disappointed that he will be away from Thornfield for several days. He has left to attend a party where he will be in the company of Blanche Ingram, a beautiful lady. Jane scolds herself for being disappointed by the news, and she resolves to restrain her fights of imaginative fancy by comparing her own portrait to one she has drawn of Blanche Ingram. Noting how much prettier Blanche is, and she is very plain woman. Okay, now I am going to discuss critical analysis from chapter 11 to 16. And this is the most important point that I am going to discuss in this in these chapters is of third phase of Jane Eyre's life. This section marks the third phase of Jane Eyre's life, in which she begins her career as a governess, and she travels to Thornfield, where the principal incidents of her life take place. By linking Jane's stages of development to the various institutions or geographic location with which she is involved, we see that first her life was at Gateshead. That was her first phase of life. The second was Lowood, and the third one was Thornfield. So by keeping in view these three stages of life, let me introduce a new terminology with you that is that you might have not heard before. That is buildings. That is buildings Roman. The book basically positions itself among a literary genre known as buildings Roman. The Buildings Roman is a novel that details the growth and development of a main character through several periods of life, which actually began as the German genre in the 17th century, but by the mid-1800s had become firmly established in England as well. Such important Victorian novels are David Copperfield, which actually based on these forms and which continues as important literary subgenre even today. The building's roman typically told the story of a man growing from boyhood to adulthood. So Charlotte Bronte's appropriation of the form for her heroine represents one of the many ways in which her novel challenges the accepted Victorian conceptions of gender hierarchy, making the statement that a woman's inner development merits as much attention as analysis as that of a woman. So she is introducing a new form of Bildungsroman novel that are based on the life of a woman, from her life from the childhood to the life of adulthood as a mature person. So next point I would like to discuss with you is Jane Eyre as a feminist novel, or what I would like to say is that what feminist movement is. I know this is semester 2, but at the moment only thing that I can tell you about feminism is that it is a movement that is basically concerned about women's rights. So this is the basic introduction of the feminist movement, and in the course of literary theory you will be reading more about that. So we see that Jane herself and Jane Eyre as a novel are often identified as important early figures of the feminist movement. We see that Jane experiences much inner questions regarding her gender role. She's not a staunch and confident feminist at all times. That is, while Jane is possessed of an immensely integrity and a determination to succeed on her own terms, her failure to conform to ideals of female beauty nonetheless troubles her and makes her question herself. A very important point that I would briefly discuss over there is of Jane Eyre as an autobiographical novel. Just as Jane's time at Lawood involved a number of elements taken from Charlotte Bronte's own life, so too is Jane's career as a governess, based on part on Bronte's short-lived position as a governess in the late 1830s. So about Jane Eyre's position as governess and about the history of being a governess in a Victorian society, I would elaborate more about it in my next lecture. For the time being, the point I would like to make is that governess is basically a symbol of ambiguous class standing. In many ways, Bronte's exploration of the role of the governess represents the novel's most important and challenging treatment of the theme of social class, just as Emily Bronte does with Heathcliff in Wuthering Heights. Charlotte Bronte makes Jane a figure of ambiguous class standing. Consequently, she is a source of extreme tension for the characters around her. But while Heathcliff, who is also an orphan like Jane, achieves wealth and power without achieving education or social grace, Jane acquires the manners, sophistication, and education of an aristocrat while remaining penniless and powerless. Such was the role of the governess brought into wealthy Victorian households as the children's private tutors in both academics and equals to them in etiquettes. The governess were actually expected to possess the demeanor of aristocracy, but as paid employees they were in many ways treated as servants or sometimes even below servants. So Jane begins to experience this tension as soon as she notices her emerging feelings for Rochester. Though she is in some ways his social equal, but she is also his servant, and thus we cannot believe that he cannot ever fall in love with her. So this was all about critical analysis from chapter 1 to 16. For the references, the major reference that I used, I have mentioned over there. Okay, now let's discuss the homework that I would like to give you. Is that first of all, you are supposed to read first 16 chapters of the novel, and after reading first 16 chapters of the novel, you people should be watching the movie Jane Eyre 1997 version. There are a lot of versions available on the internet, but the one that I would recommend you is of 1997. I have shared the link as well, so you can watch it on YouTube. And the question after watching the movie and reading the chapters that I would like to give you is that how does the movie Jane Eyre 1997 version is different from the novel you have read? So this is your homework. I hope you people will enjoy your homework. Thank you very much. That was all for today.